Hello and welcome to another episode of the Business of Business podcast. You can find us at www.thebusinessofbusinesspodcast.com. We're on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, so please look us up. We're going to jump right into it today. This is a very timely topic. We are fortunate enough to have Colleen Elaine. She is an enthusiastic entrepreneur, best-selling author, and she's an advocate for all things related to personal development and self-love. What got my attention and why I reached out to Colleen was she had written an article or written a blog on coronavirus, coping with chaos, and how to manage uncertainty. And it's, like I said, it's a timely topic because I have a lot of questions surrounding this and, you know, a lot of personal feelings and a lot of feelings that I've seen from other people that we want to get into and discuss. But not going to delay. Colleen, thanks a lot for being with us and welcome to the show.
Well, thank you so much, Roy, for having me. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, so if you don't mind, just to get us started, tell us a little bit about yourself, kind of how you got on this journey. I guess your business is titled Bright Life Transformations, Mindset, Leadership, Self-Mastery. So, you know, tell us a little bit about why you chose this path and how you got here.
Okay, sure. So I started out my career actually as a real estate appraiser. I've been doing that for about 35 years.
Oh, wow. Okay.
My father was an appraiser, and I had no idea that that's what I would be doing. But right out of high school, I got a phone call from his secretary. My dad was out of town and said that the appraisal firm across the hall was looking for a secretary. So I started working there, and within a year, I had my real estate license, which was what I needed to appraise at the time. And then I transitioned right into becoming a certified general appraiser, which means I can appraise any property, residential or commercial.
Okay.
And so, you know, in the real estate appraisal business, I mean, I really thrived in that. And the thing that I loved most about it was connecting with my clients, connecting with mortgage brokers and homeowners. And then in the mid-90s, the whole landscape of the appraisal business and real estate changed, and they implemented something called an appraisal management company, which was a third-party go-between between, you know, the lenders and the appraisers. And so no longer did I have those relationships where I could talk with a mortgage broker and receive an appraisal request or really have, you know, in-depth conversations with homeowners anymore.
Okay.
So, yeah, so that kind of got me thinking, well, gosh, you know, the best part of doing this type of work has kind of been pulled out from under me. And what I really liked was finding out, you know, what I was doing was searching for the value of a property, and I really like uncovering value. So I thought to myself, well, how can I, you know, transition into something different with this having been all I've done for all these years? And, you know, with the passion that I have for personal development, I went into life coaching for a little bit. But then I wanted to go even deeper than the life coaching. So hypnotherapy was the perfect fit for me. So the way I look at it now is that I'm helping people discover, you know, the values within themselves and, you know, the blocks and fears and patterns that they have that are holding them back from becoming their best self.
Okay. And that's very interesting because I think, you know, we all carry around self-doubt, decisions that we've made in the past. Sometimes they still haunt us just a little bit, but, you know, we have to learn to talk to ourselves positive, and we got to keep ourselves pumped up. Nobody else is going to do that for us, for sure.
Exactly.
So, like I was saying earlier, what really caught my attention was this blog that you had written about coronavirus and, you know, coping with the chaos and how to manage. And, you know, I'm just going to start out with kind of laying everything out from my perspective and then, you know, be glad to jump in or, you know, take this conversation where you feel it needs to go. But, you know, back in February, March, when this started, I would have totally assumed that we would have gotten this behind us. And, you know, maybe we had a peak in the summer, but we got over it, even though the experts were saying we're going to have this double peak. It it's just been a long time. It seems to be dragging out. You know, we had the crisis in the beginning with some food shortage, paper towels, toilet paper, things like that. But, you know, one thing that we keep looking for every week at the grocery store is still Lysol. There's just not any Lysol spray. But, you know, it's curtailed our family visits. I'm of age that my parents are both in their late 70s, early 80s. So we're concerned about going to see them, that, you know, we definitely don't want to take anything to them, but we still try to look after them. So we've got that. It's kind of same with the kids. Generally, we would go out to eat or meet them in a public place that we've curtailed. Getting out, running around, you know, we're a little bit more open to going to the Home Depot, going to Walmart, but, you know, we limit our time at that. So, you know, that's one aspect. The other, I guess, is work for a lot of people. They, you know, unfortunately, there have been a lot that have lost their jobs. There have been a lot that have been sent home. I'm fortunate enough, I've worked from home for many years, so it's not been a huge impact on me. And I do podcasting, so I get to meet a lot of great people like yourself and talk to them. So I have that kind of social human interaction. But a lot of people that are very, very social, you know, not being able to go to the office and see their coworkers every day has been a big thing. So I guess I can just kind of let you jump in and kind of start unpacking all of this about the, you know, the chaos and the uncertainty that we see out there. And how do we cope with it? What are some coping mechanisms, I guess?
Okay, yeah. So I agree with you about the way things unfolded. Never in my wildest dreams did I ever imagine that the world could get shut down. And again, for so long. So that's kind of been a shock to everyone's system. And I kind of like to equate it to a personal earthquake. So I think that the blessing in all of this is, you know, kind of getting back to the basics of, you know, what's important to us. And again, that kind of revolves around values. You know, this time, I feel like people are being called to go within and really pay attention to what's important to them. You know, and I have found in talking to a lot of people that certain people that have noticed, you know, their income has changed, obviously, because they're no longer commuting to work. But those that have found that they can do their work from home are realizing that they prefer working at home because they don't have that extra expense of the commute. So this is a time, it's a time where we can kind of observe what's going on for us personally and for our families and, you know, extended families even, and see, you know, what worked in the past, what didn't work, you know, what's different now that we like or that we don't like. And again, it's a matter of checking in with yourself internally and seeing what it is you need. And if we take a look, I don't know if you're familiar with Maslow's hierarchy of needs, but yes, that's a pyramid. Okay.
Not intimately, but yes, I have heard of it.
Okay. Yeah. So that's just a pyramid of, you know, the theory of human motivation and the social needs of what we need in our life. So our very basic need is food, water, warmth, and rest. So for, you know, a lot of our population, that's something that has been completely, you know, shaken up for them. They aren't, you know, able to get food and water, you know, because their income has been substantially decreased. So it has, you know, it's a huge shift in our ability to feel safe and to feel secure. But there's a number of programs out there that are helping people. So, you know, that's the good news. But being able to find some sort of way, you know, whether it be connecting with a family member or connecting with friends, that's the most important thing, is to get those very basic needs met. You know, some sort of normalcy in your life where you feel safe, you feel secure, and you feel able to have, you know, the food and nourishment that you need.
Yeah, and I think, I was just going to say that not that we would ever want this to happen, but again, I'm of a certain age that, you know, I can remember pre-cell phone and sending letters the old-fashioned way. So I guess, you know, one respect, we're lucky that this happened now because, you know, like I said, my parents can reach me anytime, anywhere. If I'm out and about running, I don't have to sit by the phone at home. I can get out and do stuff and be reachable in case they need anything. But also we can do FaceTime, video conference. You know, we have a lot of ways to interact and connect without that face-to-face component.
Exactly. And I think that that's, you know, the main thing that's helping people through this right now, the ones that, you know, have been, you know, quarantined to their home for certain periods of time and not being able to go and be social or eat out or do the normal things that you would do on a day-to-day basis. So having that technology to allow us, you know, even through a Zoom call or, you know, the FaceTime, we can at least see the other person. Because we all need, you know, those intimate connections. And when we don't have those connections, that's when certain addictions can rear their heads. And so that's kind of something that's been happening right now is a lot of people are experiencing depression because they don't have those people that they can reach out to, or they feel like, you know, they can't reach out for whatever reason. They get stuck in that depression with themselves and they're not taking the initiative to reach out.
Yeah, and that's we get a lot of stats daily about the number of cases, new deaths and all that. But that's something that they touch on it. Something that they don't really go into is the, you know, the people that are struggling with things, not just the food and water, but also the depression and how that affects the household. If you're having to stay home, now all of a sudden, you know, you're confined to a smaller space with a lot with other people that may or may not be handling it as well as others are.
Right. And that's, you know, that's a big problem right now. So we have to find ways to communicate with, you know, with our, you know, our immediate family that we're living with. But it's a really tough time for people that maybe live alone. So I would encourage people to, you know, if they live in a place where they do have a neighbor, you know, knock on your neighbor's door, you know, keep your 6 feet of distance or, you know, whatever you need to do, but definitely reach out in some way, shape, or form, whether it be on the phone or just being outside in your yard and talking to a passerby. But you have to have that connection. And another thing that helps with depression is being outside in sun and, you know, because the sunlight is going to boost your serotonin. Right. And that helps people with depression or even walking. But getting some form of exercise where you're moving your body so that you're not, you know, actually sulking in your depression, because that's the worst thing that somebody can do.
Right.
Or finding some sort of hobby that you know, maybe you did when you were younger. Rekindle, you know, putting together puzzles or reading a book or anything that's going to get you out of, you know, what that norm that you've kind of gotten yourself into as, you know, we've all been through the lockdown.
Yeah. And what about the anxiety? Like I said, I've worked from home for better part of 20 years. So I feel fairly well confident in the way that I manage my work relationships as well. But maybe there are some people that are anxious now because they don't have the affirmation. They don't see their immediate supervisor or their, you know, their chain of command. You know, when you're in an office, you don't have to really make an effort. You bump into people in the hallway, in the elevator, out on the street, you know, whatever. You have that, the connection with your management. I mean, so I'm sure that there are a lot of people that are feeling maybe forgotten or kind of worried about getting left behind at work and not being in the kind of in the mix.
Right. And, you know, and anxiety is future based. It's, you know, it's anticipating something that hasn't quite yet happened. So I would encourage people that are feeling, you know, those feelings of anxiety about being, you know, missing out on things that are happening in the workplace to reach out to their supervisors and just, you know, let them know, be a little bit vulnerable, you know, in a professional way that, hey, you know, I have this situation going on, and I'm feeling this, you know, and I'm needing a little bit of support here. What do you suggest? And let that supervisor know that they need to, you know, remain in their leadership and help you through this, you know, transition that we're all experiencing. And I'm sure that, you know, any supervisor would be happy to support their staff in that way.
Yeah, and I guess we can kind of flip that around and say, as a manager or as a company, that you really need to be proactive to set these things. You know, don't let your employees get depressed and feel anxious to where they have to reach out. Why don't we develop a program where, you know, we maybe if you have a small team, have a team Zoom call once a week. You know, it doesn't have to be for hours on end. It could be for 15 minutes just to say, hey, I recognize you. I recognize your work. Y'all are doing a great job continuing through this. Questions, concerns, you know, to me, the communication just relieves so much anxiety, both in our professional and personal lives.
Exactly. And that's what it all boils down to is communication. So if those, you know, top leaders in the organization can reach down and communicate with their employees, just to, like you said, let them know, hey, you're doing a great job, or, you know, thank you for this report that you turned in. And, you know, just some type of camaraderie, or doing some type of team building skill or something like that would be helpful to people, just to know that they're still connected. But yeah, communication is definitely key. And that goes back also to, you know, our family units where we're home and in lockdown and less activity outside of the home, is really communicating our thoughts and our feelings with each other, because nobody knows what you're going through. You know, we all have ideas of what somebody's going through, but we don't really know unless we ask the question.
Right, right. And we could be more tolerant. I have been impressed with people that, you know, I communicate with and have been in contact, that we seem to not be as uptight as I thought they would be, with children being on parents' laps, with dogs, you know, even doing this podcast. You know, we've got two dogs that every now and then something sparks them and they will go off. We try to, you know, just kind of, it's keeping it real. It is what it is, but not feeling like that everything has to be so perfect, because we're all pretty much living in the same, under the same constraints, or, you know, we've all got basically the same problems. Maybe mine's dogs because my kids are grown, but, you know, if you're a younger parent, maybe it's a child. But number one, you know, I would tell them to be at ease because we realize this. And then I would say to those that don't realize it, is that we need to take a step back and realize that what's really important in this world. And yeah, we have to work to eat, but a lot of these families are struggling, not only because, you know, our schools are all messed up. It's like we're doing, you know, they have virtual school, then they have split, some virtual, some in, then they like bring them in saying, no, everybody's coming in. And then now some have had more COVID exposure, so now they're saying, okay, well, we're going to send you back home. And then it's like now they're figuring out that a lot of these online programs aren't reaching a lot of kids. I'm not a virtual learner. I went to, you know, I did my graduate degree very late in life, and I could have done it online, but I opted to take in-person classes because that's the way I learn. And I can't stand the online component. So I feel for, you know, the children today that are struggling through their education. And but anyway, I think the point is that as managers, as a company, even just as other human beings, we have to realize that the struggles that everybody's going through, some struggle of their very own.
Exactly. And I think that, you know, that's, you know, where we're all, you know, we hear that a lot too, that we're all in this together. And so we're all having to really, you know, understand patience and understand compassion, because we're all experiencing something that is completely abnormal from, you know, what we've all been living. And, you know, we hear people say, oh, when are things going to get back to normal? Well, I think that we're in a time where we get to say for ourselves, what is our new normal going to be?
Right.
You know, because with this time that we've had to kind of go within and figure out what's working for us, what's not, what would I rather be doing? Or now that I have all this time, how do I want to spend it? Because a lot of people are changing careers right now, too, realizing that, you know, I was in something I didn't want to do, so now I'm going to do this instead. So it's a huge opportunity for people to build a new foundation for where they want their new normal to go.
Yeah, no, that's a good point that some people have been able to make that choice for themselves, and some people have had that choice made for them that it's, you know, it's time to seek out something. And, you know, I'm one of the very fortunate ones that I've got a job in a business that continue on no matter what. There's been a lot of changes in the way that we do things, but really, I haven't been affected. And again, in my personal life, I am busy. I'm busy at home, not only with working, but with stuff going around here. So, not getting out hasn't affected me as much as I know that there are some other people that, you know, it's just taken a toll on them not being able to get out and be social.
Yes, exactly.
So that kind of brings us to another point. And you said the new normal, you know, we don't know what that is. This may be the new normal, but we definitely can probably be assured that normal is not going to be what it was last November, December. Our new normal going forward is going to be, you know, somewhere in between where we are now and where we were then, for sure. But besides that, and in conjunction with that, what are the long-term effects that you think that we're going to see? I mean, if we get a vaccine, this lifts tomorrow, you know, in a month, 6 weeks, are 90% of the people going to bounce back and it's going to be just like, you know, they will be okay? Or is this, and I'm talking more about the personal effects of depression, you know, is this going to be a lingering effect that it's going to take years and years to unwind?
Well, I think for the people that, you know, are looking for that vaccine, see, it all goes back to your beliefs. If you believe that the vaccine is what you need to get you through this, then once that vaccine comes out, those people are likely going to get that vaccine, and yes, they're going to bounce back because they're going to have that sense of safety and security. That's what it all boils down to, is what does safety and security mean to you?
Okay.
Is it the job that you've been in for, you know, 20 years or for 5 years? Is it paving a new path? Is it, maybe downsizing or, you know, moving location? So it's going to look different for everybody, but that's what, and especially people that are in a depression right now, they need to really think about, well, you know, what would turn my life around? You know, they've got to have something that's going to pull them out of that depression. And it may very well be that vaccine for them, but it may also be reconnecting with friends and family.
Okay.
So.
Yeah. And reading through the blog, it seemed like that you said something about, I can't put my finger on it, but I like the term that you used. I think it was worry story, that we tell ourselves a worry story. So,
yes.
You know, we do that, but, you know, can we flip that switch and, you know, are there ways that we can combat that? And instead of always being focusing on the negative, like, oh, I can't see this person, I can't do that. But on the flip side, it's like, you know what? I've got a roof over my head. I'm healthy. None of my family has come down with this. And, you know, kind of flip the narrative to be more on the positive. I guess that's the gratitude as well.
Right. So an exercise that people can do if they're experiencing that worry story is I would encourage them to get a piece of paper and then draw a line, you know, vertical line down the center. And on the left side of the paper, write what if, and then write down every, you know, horrible, catastrophic thing that is in your mind. You know, do kind of like a brain dump and get all of that out on one side of the paper. And then on the other side of the paper, I would encourage them to say, what if, and then everything positive, you know, grand, big, large, beautiful that could happen, you know, instead of those other things. And as you write a positive, cross out a negative, write another positive. What if, you know, what if I got the, my dream job, and then cross off the negative. So go down that paper and cross off every negative thing on your list and add a positive.
Oh, that's a great idea. And I think we need to probably do that most of the time anyway, but now it's even more important that, you know, we just, sometimes I think we can get kind of bogged down in our own negative think, and this is a good way to kind of help keep boosting that positive, keep us on the train, and then we'll get to a point that, you know, where we're going to finally figure out where we're going to be. Like I said, I don't think it's going to be where it was last year, but I don't feel like we will always be in the spot that we're in right now. It seems like there's some, you know, some jobs are opening up, companies are coming back. I think a lot of it depends on, you know, the spread within the groups that we are in. And then, you know, of course, we're going into this holiday season. It's going to affect, I guess, probably have a larger effect on our older population. Would you suspect that?
Yes, absolutely. Because a lot of, I know a lot of the nursing homes and, you know, assisted living facilities are still not allowing family members to come in. And human connection is the number one thing that we all need. And in particular for our elderly population, you know, they rely on that. And even though they have, you know, the nurses and whatnot that come through, it's not the same as their family. You know, they need to feel that love of their family. So, I mean, even just if you could send a card to your loved one if you can't see them physically, or plan to make a phone call where they can see you on FaceTime, or even send a small gift if you can. You know, our elderly population is really feeling this, you know, most of all, because they don't have that, you know, that human connection with us.
Yeah, and we're actually going through that right now. You know, my partner Terry and her mother had been in the hospital for about 10 days and just got her released. She went back. She did live in a very nice continuing care retirement community where she lived in an independent apartment, and then they have a rehab floor. So released her, went to the rehab floor. You know, they have limited visitation, but Terry and her sisters had to go get the COVID test. As long as they could prove they had a fresh test of negative, they could come in and visit. So this all happened Tuesday. Wednesday morning, she gets a phone call. Somebody on this unit, the fourth floor, somebody tested positive. So now they've shut it down from visitors again. So yeah, it's a, you know, and I guess and the other thing is that maybe not so much, I mean, it is, there is some anxiety wrapped around of what's going on. But the other thing is things change so very quickly. I mean, just like that, it's like mom was getting out, going to be able to, you know, have visitors and things were good. And then all of a sudden, you know, overnight, not so much. It just changed on a dime.
Right. And I think that that's, you know, that's part of the anxiety that's going on right now, is that people are used to having their lives, you know, set out in a certain way. And now, you know, it's, you know, the landscape is changing moment by moment, and something that you plan for tomorrow may not happen.
Right.
So we're all, yeah, we're all feeling, you know, that instability. And so the best thing that we can do for ourselves is, you know, have compassion for ourselves that, okay, you know, everything is happening for a reason. You know, we don't yet know what the reason is, but, you know, if we can be centered in where we are and, you know, in gratitude of what we have surrounding us, you know, whether that be family or a nice place to live or food, whatever it is, you know, be grateful for what we have, because everything is changing in the moment and none of us really know what's ahead.
Yeah. And, you know, and some larger events that take months and months to plan, or where they have to plan them way in advance, you know, they are already canceling. We have a, you know, a huge stock show rodeo here in town that happens in January, late January, early February. and they've already canceled it. And, you know, I understand because they have to have so much notice to set up events, caterers, you know, everything that it takes to put that event on. I just heard on the radio yesterday, we're huge concert goers, so that's been a, you know, kind of a drawback for us as we haven't been able to go out and go to the concerts. But I heard that some of these artists, they've written 2021 off, and they're just looking out to 2022, not even thinking about it. So, you know, so many events that take so much time, lead time preparation, just getting, you know, obliterated, which is not only hurts the jobs that go along with all of that, but of course all of us that use that for enjoyment as well.
Right. And, you know, and that's the thing, because it affects, you know, it affects the people that are putting on the show, and it affects all the people that were employed to, you know, set everything up, and it affects all the vendors that they had scheduled and the location. And so, I mean, it's just a dwindling down, you know, all the way to the consumer who would actually go to the show. So many people are affected by everything that's going on.
Right.
And I think that that's part of, you know, how we're going to get through this, is to realize that, you know, we're all being affected in some way or another. So just to be compassionate with yourself and, you know, check in with yourself and see what it is you need to feel better in the moment.
Okay. Well, Colleen, it's been wonderful speaking with you. I want to urge everybody to go over to your website. It's ColleenElaine.com and read this Coronavirus Coping with Chaos and How to Manage Uncertainty. It is well worth the read. I've got two final questions for you. Number one is, so what is a tool or a ritual or process that you use in your life, you know, on a fairly regular daily basis that you just can't live without? And then, of course, I will ask you to, you know, follow that up with who your clients are, what you can do for them, and how they can get a hold of you.
Okay, sure. Yeah, so the process that I use, and I use this throughout every day, is I like to just kind of center myself and take a few deep breaths. And I like to breathe in a positive word and exhale anything that I'm feeling that might have some kind of negative connotation attached to it. So I may be breathing in peace and breathing out fear. And then I like to, you know, drink a nice glass of water, keeping my body hydrated. And then the third thing I like to do is to ground myself, you know, taking my shoes off, and either, you know, if you're in an office environment, if you can take your shoes off onto your desk, that's great. But if you're at home and you can get outside and put your feet in the grass, it's even better. It helps you disconnect from technology for a little bit and from any kind of negativity or fear-based emotions that are coming on. And it just gets you centered with the earth. So breathing, hydration, and getting grounded.
Oh, that's great advice. Those are things I don't do. And I actually have a list of things that hang over my desk, and people kind of laugh when they see it, because it's like, you know, learn something new, sweat every day, and then I have breathe. People laugh at that, but, you know, I am the world's worst about holding my breath. And I've even been pointed out, I used to take some martial arts, and the instructor, he would walk by and be like, "It's okay, take a breath, you're good." We went to the wine painting where there's 20 people in the room, and the instructor's kind of going over, you know, use color 1, 2, 3 and help you through this. And she came by and tapped me on the shoulder more than once and said, "This is supposed to be fun. Take a breath." But I was so intent that, you know, I just held my breath. So I think that's very good advice. Just learn to breathe.
Well, yeah. And I'm glad you said that, Roy, because until you become aware of taking the time to consciously breathe, you'll start realizing how much you actually hold your breath. And I have been guilty of that in my life too. So yes, that's why I do this practice, is because I was one of those hold your breathers.
All right. Well, tell people, you know, who is your client, and, you know, what can you do for them, and then how can they reach you?
Okay, sure. I work with overwhelmed and anxious entrepreneurs. And so what I do is hypnotherapy and regression particularly RTT therapy, which is rapid transformational therapy. So I help my clients release any blocks or fears or false beliefs or negative habits and patterns that are preventing them from living fully. And once they are set free from those empowering beliefs, they can, you know, find their authentic truth and create a life that they would love living.
All right.
And great. Anyone can find me at ColleenElaine.com or on Facebook at Bright Life Transformations, and I spell Bright, B-R-I-T-E. And I'm on Twitter at C-E Millett, M-I-L-L-E-T-T. And lastly, at Instagram at ColleenElaine_hypnotist.
All right, great. And we will put all that contact information not only in the show notes, but also on our website. Again, Colleen, thank you so much for coming and speaking with us today on this timely topic. We certainly appreciate it, and I think we've got some good tools that we can take away with us here to, you know, help us cope with this, you know, what we're all going through right now. Well, thanks for listening. This is Roy, the Business of Business podcast. You can find us at www.thebusinessofbusinesspodcast.com. We're also on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Look forward to talking to you next time. Thank you very much.